Welcome to the Solar Energy Week. What is the current status of solar energy? To gain some insight into the current status, I would like to discuss the production of solar modules. We will consider different aspects of the production, starting off with the annual installation of PV technology. This figure shows the global annual installed peak power in gigawatt peaks as a function of time. The solar cell production shows an exponential increase over the last 14 years. Between 2000 and 2011, the overall production increases annually by more than 40%, which is an unprecedented growth. The figure also shows the relative contribution of the various PV technologies. The green and yellow colors represent the monocrystalline silicon and the multicrystalline silicon PV technologies, respectively. As you can see, these wafer-based modules are the dominant technology and contribute to around 90% of the total module production and installations. The inorganic thin film PV technologies like cadmium telluride, CIGS, and amorphous silicon are responsible for the remaining 10%. This figure shows the contribution of various nations to the worldwide solar module production. The vertical axis represents the percentage of the total annual production. The horizontal axis represents time going back 20 years. We can see that the location of the production has strongly shifted over the last decade. Up to 2006, Japan and the US, denoted by yellow and pink, had a combined market share of roughly 60%. The European market share, denoted by gray, was increasing slowly up to a decade ago. From 2006 onwards, we see a big growth of the production in China and Taiwan, denoted by orange. This growth was made possible by huge investments of the Chinese government in scaling up PV module manufacturing in China. In 2015, around 75% of all PV modules were produced in China and Taiwan. We are now looking at the worldwide cumulative installed PV power, which was up to 2012 exponentially increasing in time. The different colors reflect the different regions in the world. The green area corresponds to Europe, which shows that historically the majority of PV systems are installed in Europe. A large fraction of the PV capacity in Europe is installed in Germany. The Asian Pacific region, shown in orange, has recently caught up with Europe. Most of the PV power in Asia is installed in Japan and in China. China is the fastest growing market at the moment. This is demonstrated by the unprecedented increase in the installed PV capacity from 2010 to 2015. The light blue area reflects the PV capacity installed in North and South America. Yellow corresponds to the Middle East and Africa. It is important to note that the total installed solar power has passed the 100 gigawatt peak mark in 2012. And at the end of 2016, we are expected to pass the 300 gigawatt peak border. Another aspect that controls demand is the cost price of PV technology. How does the cost price of electricity generated by a PV system compare to the electricity delivered by your energy company? To answer this, we have to look towards the learning curves. The learning curve is the graph which shows how the cost price, in case the sales price, is dropping in time. In time, the industry gets more experience. Progress in technology provides for better PV modules with higher efficiencies. This experience results in better and faster processing, leading to higher production yields. Upscaling of production leads to lower cost of the source materials. Learning curves usually show an exponentially decreasing cost price in time until the technology or product is fully developed. In this graph, we have the average global sale prices of a PV module in inflation-adjusted euro per watt peak. The sales price is plotted against the cumulative production in gigawatt peaks. Important to note is that the sales prices, discounting some fluctuations, follow a largely exponential decay. Currently, the average retail of PV modules is below 50 cents per watt peak. Now, we will see how the cost price of a PV system is not only determined by the module. The red dots show the decrease in the cost price of a complete PV system. As you can see, in the early days of the PV technology, the system price was dominated by the module price. In the current situation, however, the contribution of the non-modular components start to play the most dominant role. By non-modular components, we consider components like the racking, wiring, inverter, battery for standalone systems, or even maintenance cost. The difference between the red and blue line corresponds to the non-modular costs. The green curve represents the learning curve of the non-modular components. This learning curve is not dropping as fast as the module price. This means that nowadays the reduction in the cost price of a PV system will be mainly limited by the cost price of the non-modular components. This shows the advantage of crystalline silicon PV technology with respect to thin film technologies. Crystalline silicon module efficiencies range from 14% up to 22%. Higher conversion efficiency means higher yields per area. While the non-modular costs per area are the same, the cost price per watt peak of the non-modular cost will consequently be lower for modules with higher conversion efficiencies. In block 2.1, we have discussed that in 2015, hydropower is estimated to be responsible for around 16-17% of the total worldwide electricity production. Nuclear power is responsible for around 16%. The question now is, how do these numbers compare to solar energy? For that, I have constructed the following figure. On the vertical axis, you see the cumulative installed capacity expressed in gigawatts of power. Note that this is a logarithmic scale. Here we only consider the energy sources which are not based on fossil fuels. Light blue represents hydroelectricity, dark green represents nuclear, red represents wind, and dark blue represents solar. The installed nuclear power is hardly growing anymore, whereas the installed hydropower is still slightly growing in time. Wind is growing at a relatively rate of 20% per year. As you can see, from 2008, solar is the fastest growing energy technology with a rate far above 40%. However, it is not fair to compare the installed power between technologies like this. The numbers given here represent maximum power the energy source can produce, but it's not the average power the electricity source has delivered in reality. The relation between these two is called the capacity factor, as we discussed in week two, which is basically a measure of how often an electric generator runs for a specific period of time. Nuclear has with 90% the highest capacity factor, followed by hydropower with an average capacity factor of around 40%. For wind energy, I have assumed an average capacity factor of 30%. And here, for solar, I have assumed a capacity factor of 15%. The low capacity factor for PV systems can be explained by the fact that for most geographical locations, almost half of the day is devoid of solar radiation at nighttime. If you use these capacity factors, we can look at the effective installed power for these electricity sources. Currently, solar energy generates an order of magnitude less electricity than hydro and nuclear. However, I claim that the trend in the growth of solar energy will continue the coming years. If we blindly extrapolate the trend of the last 15 years, we see that the installed power of solar energy will exceed nuclear, wind, and hydropower in another decade. It's just a matter of time before solar becomes the most important energy source, not based on burning fossil fuels. But why can solar guarantee a much faster capacity growth than the other technologies? First, solar energy is everywhere and available in great abundance. realize that the total amount of energy in solar light incident on our planet is 10,000 times larger than our total energy consumption. By evaporation of water due to solar heat, hydroelectricity is a secondary form of solar energy. By solar-induced temperature difference, wind is a secondary form of solar energy. Consequently, solar energy is the biggest renewable energy source around. Secondly, hydro, nuclear, and wind are centralized electricity generation concepts. It means that you need a big dam, a big nuclear plant, or a wind park to generate electricity. Building these large systems requires governmental involvements and big investors. PV systems can be installed centralized in large solar farms too. However, the unique advantage here is that PV systems can be installed decentralized as well. Many consumers of electricity can put their own PV systems on their home. They become their own energy producer, independent of the market. Another important factor is that in most parts of the world, the cost price of a PV system have met or dropped below grid parity. This means that having your own PV system is cheaper than buying the electricity from the grid. The installation of decentralized PV systems will be the big force behind the solar revolution of the coming years. It's power to the consumers. It will change the energy landscape much faster than most people think, as is evident from this graph. As more and more people become aware of this, it's more likely that the growth will be further enhanced than that it will be slowed down. Over the course of the next couple of videos, I will introduce you to the technology behind this revolution. See you in the next blogs.